remember it vividly to this day, going down that really steep drop and saying, "Daddy, I don't like it, get me off."
Oh yeah, I have been known to scream. I mean, we took some videos in America, and in fact, my screams are drowning out my wife's screams.
Obviously, the first thing he really started talking to me about was roller coasters, and I thought it was quite interesting.
Butterfly, bank curve, Bion curve, first drop, airtime.
I saw a roller coaster was the one that I now own, Wild Mouse. It was our first visit to Littlehampton. We turned the corner on the promenade. On the roof of this building, there's this wooden monstrosity with tracks going everywhere, with about four cars flying around in different directions, people screaming their heads off. A lot of noise, a lot of clacking and banging, and it just sort of hit me. I thought, what the hell is this? I did a 3-week tour around the whole of Great Britain when I was 16. From then I went on to college. I went to art school for 4 years. I actually based all my finals on roller coasters. Initially I did a with Interrail, one of these monthly rail tickets. I toured all over Europe just going to roller coasters. My next big aim was to go on a trip to the States. So I went over there for a summer and had a job in a hotel, and that lasted for about a week, and I phoned up an amusement park and said, "Can I come and work for you?" My parents were extremely worried at one stage. They were so concerned about this obsession of mine that they got me actually worried that, you know, this was so sort of unnatural. It took me a lot of research to find out from people in America that there were thousands of other people with exactly the same hobby.
He had a magazine that I think had come out of one of the Sunday papers, hadn't it? And there was an article in there, they'd interviewed him, and he'd said in there that he wanted to get married on a roller coaster. You see, anyway, he sort of left it strategically placed so that I could read it one day when I was around at his parents. And I read it and I said, "No, you don't really, do you?" And he said, "Yeah."
I thought, well, you know, I love roller coasters and I love Tina. And I love Tina more than roller coasters, of course.
Oh.
But we had to combine, I wanted to combine those two loves on the one day. It just made it that more special though than doing it in it. Like a regular marriage in a regular church. We got all 250 guests onto the station platform, and there was thousands of people all around the edge of the ride because the Pleasure Beach put up a sign saying Britain's first roller coaster wedding here today, so everyone had come to see it.
I couldn't wear the dress I wanted because obviously getting in this roller coaster, there was no way I could have a big hoop. I mean, it would have been, you know, up in front of my face. We were just going down the drop, weren't we? And my headdress, so I had all my hair up on top, and my headdress was holding my hair up, trying to keep me looking normal. And all of a sudden, my headdress just went whoop, and the vicar spent the rest of the ride with his hands on top of my head, holding my veil like and my headdress on.
I wanted to somehow work with coasters, but at the same time, I thought, it will never happen. It's a dream, it's too far off. So I ended up in Germany for 8 years. Got a really good job as a draftsman for the military over there. And in between doing top secret tactical maneuvers for the Brits, I was designing roller coasters on the draft. I used to get a newspaper that's called the World's Fair, and it's got a list of all the rides for sale. And I looked in one issue, and it said Wild Mouse roller coaster for sale. The interesting thing was that it said phone Littlehampton, which was the first one I ever rode as a child. That was my roller coaster, and it was for sale. And I phoned the park up and said, how much is your roller coaster? My partner, who was sort of going to buy it with me, said, no, forget it, it will never work, it's too much money.
I must say, first of all, I said no, not to put him down, but it was just the financial aspect. But that changed soon after. He got prices down for his first buy. And then I thought, it is the dimensions of the price of cars people buy and just blow them up the day after.
I need new pins made up for these. You can see that the pins are badly worn. And it's going to be 1,000 new pins.
Right. I think it's pure enthusiasm that got me the loans in the end. I actually made a model of the ride. That was my next thing, was to make a scale model of it and actually present the bank manager with it and say, look, it's a fantastic ride.
It's not designed at that shape.
No,
right.
No, it should be cylindrical.
And do you know what material you got?
Some parts, basically knowing that I was an enthusiast, said, yeah, it's no problem, mate. You can put your roller coaster here, but we'll take all the money. So I obviously looked at a lot of parks, but I opted for Bream.
Well, obviously I'm training nearly every day and I'm working during the week, but I always leave the weekends free. So it's really a weekend venture, the coaster riding. What we do, we have an agreement, my wife and myself. She plans one holiday 1 year, and then the following year it's a coaster trip and I plan it. I mean, there's not so many wives that put up with both a bodybuilder and a coaster enthusiast. I mean, she's got her work cut out there.
Initially, I lived in a 14-foot caravan that was falling apart, a little touring van, actually underneath or right next to the structure of the roller coaster as I was building it. And I survived that for about 5 years in freezing cold. But the ride actually took me almost 2 years to build because it was a catch-22 situation. I didn't have enough money to be able to do it with a big team of people. I was working on my own totally. I encountered sort of problem after problem. I realised that about 80% of the timber would have to be replaced. The ride was about 25 years old. A lot of the timber had seen better days and it was rotten around the bolts. There was no way you could get around it. The whole lot had to be replaced. The worst thing that happened was I had the ride near completion and we had a really bad spell of weather. We had severe gales, this was in January. I was just getting it ready for that season. And I hadn't put all of the diagonal bracing on that secures the structure, stops it from falling. And we had a tremendous gale one afternoon and the whole lot collapsed in front of me. It just sort of sank like a sour blancmange. I had to sort of keep going back to the bank and saying, listen, I need this money for this. If I don't do this, then I won't get my safety certificate. It's got to be done properly. I can remember the first day I actually opened was on a Saturday afternoon. I was totally unprepared. I had no sign saying open. The first thing I had to do was rush off to Western Supermare and go and get some adhesive letters and make a sign saying that the cost of the ride and that we were actually open after all this time, because people were so used to the ride not being open and being in the process of being built. Actually, it sort of hit me by a surprise when I got my safety certificate that afternoon and I could suddenly open the ride to the public, which was a whole new dimension. My father did me a great honour because he was the first paying customer
and he insisted in symbolically paying for the first ride. The enthusiasm's there, but at the same time, over the last 5 years or last 7 years, I've actually suffered physically because of all that I've been through. It's not quite as easy getting up and crawling around the tracks in the morning. I sort of genuinely start to feel my age now. And I ended up sort of up to my neck in debt with horrendous interest rates.
The magazine, the club magazine, is called First Drop, of course, after the first drop of a coaster, which is generally the top element of a ride. The magazine will tell you news about what's new, it will be news about the rest of the world, reports on rides, reports on new rides, reports on how rides work, people behind them. Well, unfortunately, there is a lot of jargon. We try and steer away from the jargon, but the jargon is in there. All you'll hear terms such as butterfly, bank curve, bion curve, first drop, airtime, negative Gs, boomerangs, butterflies, loops, multi-inversion, the list is endless, you know. The G-forces and the airtime are very tied together, and they're what most hardened thrill riders are looking for. The G-forces is the amount of pressure being applied on your body into the seat. Most rides in this country will hit about 3 or 4. A really good ride, a really exceptional, really extreme ride will hit 6, maybe 7 Gs, and at that point the blood's rushing out of your head so fast you can almost pass out. Every year we have the trips to all the parks, and a good relationship means a good day out. For example, when we go to a park, we'll get an exclusive ride session, an ERS, on a new ride. In fact, we know the planning office of every major park in the UK, and we give them regular phone calls just to see what's happening.
Piece of the ride where it's very close to the people queuing?
The bit where it's closest actually is when they come down the pole.
I think roller coasters 24 hours a day. I sleep, drink roller coasters, and I'm always thinking up new ideas that I think would work really well. Initially, I bought a lot of spare tracks from another ride that was identical to the ride I've got, but always in the back of my mind was the idea I would love one day to do my own layout and design. I finally got the go-ahead last year from the park owner at Bream to go ahead and do this second design. Most rides these days are designed on computer. Unfortunately, I don't have that luxury, so I've done it the way that they were designed in the 20s and 30s, which is pretty much on the drawing board. Right, what I'm trying to do with the new ride I'm designing is to make it something totally different to the existing ride, and without having everyone going on either one ride or the other, and then spending all the money on one ride, and then not going on the other ride. I'm trying to create a total contrast. For that reason, the new design is going to be, it's not going to have the dips, but therefore it's going to have lots of sharp hairpin curves, and it's going to be in the dark. I was lucky to be able to actually use parts of my blueprints for the original ride. I actually cut them up like a jigsaw puzzle and piece them together to create the new ride.
The best time actually for me to do this sort of thing is in the middle of the night, because I seem to be at my most creative that time, burning the midnight oil.
It's running out through the front here, and it's going to cross over at the front.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you'll see as we go along.
Okay.
Because hopefully we'll get quite a few bits of truck up today.
How long is it? How long will the ride be?
What, in sort of
time-wise?
It'll be about two-thirds of the size of this ride, so... But it won't have dips. It'll be just a...
Just a
gradual
slope back down to the station.
Well, the idea is it's going to be a ride that sort of builds and builds, like this sort of... proud of the fact that it's the only one of its type in the world now, but because it's got a very low capacity, you can only run four cars with two people per car, so in terms of making money, it's a dead horse, really. I think the roller coaster fans in this country, without being big-headed, I think they admire and respect what I've achieved, what I've done, and that I've saved a classic ride. I'll get days where I'm extremely depressed, and then things will go wrong. Everything is really complicated. Perhaps at the end of that particular day, you will get everything sorted out, and the next day everything will go really smoothly. And it's the roller coaster ride in itself.
The new ride is like the fear of it not being complete. You know, that's the theming.
Come round the bend, and then there's the end of the track.
He's very enthusiastic, and obviously he's got ideas, but I sometimes tend to be a bit of a mistake.
Think
it'd be
running for Easter.
He's
only got 3 weeks.
Easter next year.
I think it's a bit ambitious for
I think it's Easter next year.
It's too ambitious for the start of this season.
Yeah, I think
you're right. And he is in a situation where his lifeline is pontins in the surrounding campsites.
Which made it was stupid to put a new ride at this park. You should have gone somewhere else.
Easter is very critical for us because it's we're hungry for money, then we were sort of more or less, we have to survive through the winter. It's a severe cash flow problem at that time of year.
Push! I am pushing! Richard, you got behind him.
Rope job. It's just, I totally underestimated the amount of time that the new ride would need, and it's taken a lot longer than we thought. I knew that there's still a lot to do on this, getting this one ready for Easter weekend. I would have liked to have it all tidy and cleared up here. I mean, it does put the punters right off if it looks a bloody mess in the middle of the ride. But we're still putting a station together at the moment. Right, get a metal drill bit, 12 mil. Oh, Jesus. This is typical. A bolt head stuck in there, and we've got to drill through the bolt head. I mean, it should be a simple procedure to just drill through the hole and through the wood. But we got something in the way, and it's going to take us ages to get through it. I'm totally out of money now, basically. I got my last £10 in my pocket, and, you know, I need punters on the ride.
I think when you look at the world in general, it's extremely black on a global scale. You stand there and look at a roller coaster ride, and it's giving millions of people a very innocent and pure form of pleasure, which I think is fantastic. Sometimes it's just the comment of a little kid who's been on it. It's sort of scared the pants off him, as it did with me when I was at that age, when I took my first ride on it. And you get a little kid taking their first ride ever on a roller coaster, and they come off, and you know it's been a traumatic experience for them, but it's really sort of been one of the high points of their life, that particular moment when they stepped onto my ride. And then they usually come off in fits of laughter and loving it, because it's sort of so shocking.